everybody. It's Fran. Again, but really not again. This is the first time I'm trying this out. Trying this whole idea of doing a regular podcast so that you can hear my ramblings and then just sort of download it, take it on the go. Yes, so podcast number one, I guess the main thing that's been occupying my daily life has been the move, the endless move. A couple of snags. I had to move things ahead a bit because the new space was not as ready as it really kind of appeared at first and second inspection. As I've gotten into it, there's just so many things wrong. I've been having to fill holes and, you know, drafts, and it's just one thing after another, and every time that I work on the space, I find more things that I have to fix, and it's just, I've got this long list of things that I have to deal with before I get the major furniture moved in, because as I get the stuff moved in there, it's going to be harder to get around on a ladder and get up and into things. So it's been taking a lot of my time just over there. So the time that I had planned to be packing things and getting things ready to move is being gobbled up by working on the new space. I guess it's sort of par for the course. But I thought that the topic of this podcast should be about books and records, because in the process of packing up all my books and packing up all my records, you sort of rediscover them. And it was a very emotional experience. This whole thing has been a very emotional experience. Packing up your belongings, especially after you get things in a certain order and you're used to it, and you know where things are, and then you have to tear it all up, put it into boxes, move it somewhere else, and then try to reassemble it. And of course, even though I took great pains to try and keep everything in order, when I got to the other side, I just like, well, you know, I just got to change the order of the books. And I got another bookcase so that things weren't as crammed, and so that I could kind of reorder my books because they had sort of gotten disordered, and the albums are all out of order and whatnot. And so in the process of going through them once again, just lots of feelings. I mean, every book that I own has a memory and a time, and every album that I have is just filled with emotions. And going through the records, packing them up, I just couldn't help but think that I wanted to put every single record I had in my hand on the platter and listen to it. It's like, why haven't I listened to this record this year? Why haven't I listened to this record, you know, this month? Just so many, like, emotions. And I'm taken back to a very good quote that I heard Warren Zevon say before he passed away. Obviously, he had given interviews for this documentary about his final days, and in that documentary he said a quote that he claims he did not invent, but it is a good quote nonetheless, that we like to buy books because we like to believe that we are buying the time to read them. And that has really been on my mind a lot this week. I do think of that quote often, especially whenever I buy another book or another record. It translates into many things that we collect for comfort. Music, books, movies, things that tie us to our past, nostalgic things. Although I don't think books are necessarily nostalgic, but I think in thinking about my own collection, my own library, so many books that I would have liked to have owned that I either didn't get because I didn't have the money for it, which is almost always the case, or didn't have the space for it, which often was also the case. I can't help but collect books that, even if I don't necessarily have the time to read it or the patience to read it, especially if it's a more of a resource type book, which I do own a lot of, especially in art books and science books. A lot of books I'll buy just for reference, even though I would never read it cover to cover, a compendium on art that might be 700 pages. But I like having it, the idea that I can look into it and use it as a reference. Even in the age of Google everything, there are a lot of things in my collection that you'll never find on Google. It's just true. One of these days, I'm going to have to do a video about my rare videos. Not YouTube videos, but VHS and Laserdisc videos. I do have some titles on Laserdisc that are worth talking about, and some titles on VHS that are worth talking about, too. I do remember very fondly the days of the golden age of video, and back up in New York, because I was in New York in the 90s, in the late 90s, there was a spot on St. Mark's. It was called Mondo Kim's. And if you went in there, it was four floors of video. Well, the first floor was records, and then the other three were, it was video, VHS, and they had, back at the time, the whole fourth floor was Laserdiscs. And you could find virtually anything. And it's not like a Blockbuster or like a video rental place that you'd have in your regular town. If you went to Mondo Kim's, they had whole aisles of just like Japanese videos or videos from Italy or Germany, compendiums of like cult films from all over the world and all kinds of times. If there was any kind of like micro genre that you wanted to see on video, they had it there. And it was just a candy store of video, if you really love video, especially back in the days of cable access shows in the 80s and early 90s, when local cable access productions were probably the most entertaining, best value for your dollar video that you could watch. And at Mondo Kim's, they would collect videos from various local cable access shows that you could watch. And even in New York, they had some really great, many great cable access shows, Ghoul A Go-Go being among the tops. And there were some other really great ones too, whose titles probably escape me at this point. But YouTube, for me, it sort of harkens me back to those days in the 80s and 90s when cable access was king, and where you could watch really creative, low-budget, sort of flying-by-the-seat-of-your-pants, total entertainment on TV. I do, of course, like most people, like watching the big production YouTube shows, people who have very, very good writing, very good personalities, very good production value. But there was something about cable access, a craziness to it, a sort of desperation, which is very rare, even on YouTube these days. Hard to describe. I guess you'd have to go on YouTube and sort of look at some vintage cable access shows, but there was a sincerity. I mean, I'm going to say for the best cable access shows, the ones that were really really caught my fancy, there was a combination of desperation, honesty, ambition, and just love of video that sort of was present in all of the shows that I used to like watching. Even the ones that were bad were almost impossible to not watch just because it was just so entertaining, I suppose. And I'm not going to say that the content of cable access was great. Usually it was not. It was usually banal. But it was all about the people and the times. And it was a slower time. The pace of life was slower. There was a reverence for the time slot that a show would come on. It might have been a 15-minute show or a half-hour show. But you would put everything aside in your schedule, make time to be there in front of the set just to watch some idiotic, you know, 15-minute show when they might have like a cool musical guest on or do something that you hadn't heard of before. It was really just everything. I guess the thing I like about YouTube is it does have a sort of a spark of that. What it doesn't have is the desperation, and what I mean by that is, like doing live radio or doing a cable TV show, you know, you got to keep it down to a certain format, to a certain time slot, and if it's live broadcast, there's a lot of pressure to sort of get it all in, get it right, and there's an artistry to that that you lose in editing, of course. But I don't know, I guess it's the same reason I still love listening to live radio, and in Philadelphia we've got a few really good free format stations that you can pick up off air that I do listen to every day. And I have considered doing another radio show, and there's a new radio station that's popped up, and I've really thought that I would like to do a pilot, to get back on the air and do another radio show, to do music, because you can't do music on YouTube anymore. You can't do music in a podcast anymore without getting sued and fined. But radio is really kind of the last bastion of that. And I still love the idea of doing like a live music show. And it has been on my mind to do that once again, if I should have the time. So, but I did want to wrap up this first podcast. I want to keep it short and portable. But let me know what you think. If you like the podcast idea, you can leave a comment on the YouTube page. I'm going to sort of put a link on my YouTube page in the sort of commentary. And I will host it on my regular website. And I'm not really sure. I don't really have a way of doing comments there, but you can leave a comment on the YouTube thing, or you can, you know, send an email comment or whatever. But let me know what you think. If you like this whole podcast idea, I will keep doing it. So, anyway, that's it. I'm Fran. I'll see you around again for number, what, 2? And then beyond for the Fran podcast. Don't really have a name for it yet. FranCast, maybe? FranCast? We'll think of a word. Anyway, that's it. I'm Fran. I'll see you soon. Bye!